So I will talk about Polarons, not surprisingly. I will mostly focus on titania and zinc oxide. I'm an experimentalist, so I will focus mainly on infrared spectroscopy to detect polarons, and I will discuss a few problems arising from that. I should say that some of my interest in polarons comes from solving the energy problem, light for energy, conversion of light into chemical energy, and so on, requires photochemistry. And so if I look at these reaction schemes you find in the typical review papers on photochemistry, on photoactive oxides, they typically look like this. So you excite electrons in the conduction band, so you store energy. So in a more detailed fashion, this is here. So first you create an exciton, and then somehow the exciton is split in an electron and in a hole. And then you can use this electron in the conduction band to activate molecules sitting on the surface. Actually, if you think about this, this is in fact not quite correct. If you look at the photophysics, if you split the exciton to have a hole and an electron, or two polarons, if you like, of course you lose quite a bit of energy because these energies, these binding energies are quite substantial. And so in titania, there are different values if you look in the literature, but they are certainly substantial with regard to the band gap. So you need to consider them. So to draw pictures like this is simply not correct. You have the full photophysics will need to look into these polarons. Interestingly, if you look in the literature, there's a lot of very nice experiments, time-resolved experiments, very high time resolution on exciton formation. Like Julia Strehler at the Fritz Haber Institute in Berlin, she does beautiful experiments on these very short timescales. But if we want to do photochemistry with it, we have to look at longer timescales. We have to transport the excitation from the bulk where it's generated to the surface. And so we should look at polarons. Okay, so actually there is some data around. Some of the first data are from Hiroshi Onishi's group. He did, he looked on titania powders. And he clearly sees when he illuminates these powders with UV light, he gets an absorption band in the infrared. So there is a clear signal. If he stops the UV radiation, the signal decays. So these are certainly photo excitations, and which were assigned by electrons sitting in trapped states. But actually, these experiments were not so well defined. They are actually on P25. This is a powder for the colleagues in theory, which is a mixture of rutile and annatase. Normally, annatase is considered to be the more active one. But of course, these particles are not so well defined. And the next step forward were experiments by John Yates and colleagues. They also looked at P25 powder. I will tell you why they all looked at powders in a second or so. What they found is that they see the same effect if they excite with UV light, but also if they expose their samples to hydrogen atoms. So hydrogen atoms, they would diffuse inside the titania powder materials, immediately dissociate and give an electron to the conduction band. So this was a very nice system proving what one sees here are actually electron polarons. Of course, these questions all remain. Are these defects, which role do vacancies play? Step edges, is it annatase or rutile? And so we thought about in order to make collaboration with theory easier, we should get data for single crystals. Very well defined, as best as we can, experimentally single crystals. However, there's a problem with single crystals. If you go for transmission, infrared transmission through single crystals, there is a lot of absorption in the infrared and you hardly get any signal. So there is actually very old data by Kronemeyer quite a while ago, where he showed that actually there is a absorption in the infrared, which shows up at about 1.5 or so EV, which must be related to the polarons localized at oxygen vacancies, because the difference between these samples is he subjected them to a rather thorough heat treatment. So there is a signature in the infrared. But if you actually look at the transmission, it's hopeless in the infrared regime to work with single crystals with a thickness of a few tens of a millimeter. Is basically hopeless, and this is an illustration of the same fact. If you look at the phonons, the optical phonons are of several dozen milliEV for both actually titania and zinc oxide. So as soon as you get above the energy of the longitudinal optical phonons, you have, if you work in transmission, very strong absorption, and it's basically impossible to work out any other details. Okay, so what is our approach? Our approach is actually using IRAS, which is infrared reflection absorption spectroscopy. So we don't work in transmission, we work in reflection. First, I should say that this is very difficult because the reflectivity of dielectrics in the infrared regime, if you come in at grazing incidence, is very low. And I'm just going to take you through this slide. Actually, if you compare to metals, you lose at least two orders of magnitude in intensity. In some cases, it's even more. So this is experimentally very, very difficult. So you cannot use a standard infrared reflection instrument, which many laboratories have, and look at the dielectrics. So what we did in Karlsruhe is actually we have now arrived at the second generation already, a dedicated instrument where we played all tricks which are available to us to improve sensitivity, to improve signal to noise. And I think for the experimentalists among you, we believe that going for a single frame infrared spectrometer is the key point here. So we can go down to 10 at the minus 6 changes in reflectivity. And there are not so many apparatuses on this planet which can do this. If you want to see a recent list of things we look at, I recommend this paper. Important for this apparatus is that we can do infrared reflection absorption spectroscopy, but we can also look at powders. We have a way to change our optical path so that we can also put zinc oxide titania powders in this apparatus, so to compare with the previous results. Yeah, it's of course ultra high vacuum in order to be able to control the surface chemistry. We can go down to 50K. Okay, so now here's the data. This is what I actually showed to you before, the powders. This is now rutile powder, not this P25 anymore, which is very popular, but really titania powder. This is Anatas powder, looks sort of similar. But now this is single crystal data now. And so what I show for the single crystals is always different spectra that are recorded such that I measure the reflectivity of the sample before I shine in UV light and before I expose to hydrogen atoms, and then I compute a different spectrum. So this is the black line here. I'm not going to show it any further. Would be the different spectra from two measurements recorded immediately one after other, just to show you what the signal to noise is here is. And so the red curve would be after exposure to hydrogen atoms. And here now you see the difference. First, in the case of the single crystal data, we see certainly sharper peaks. We see a second feature here. And interestingly, for Anatas, it looks quite different. Basically, there is no signal. So let's look in some more detail. This is again after UV. And for the single crystals, now we see here three different features. And the assignment of this data is certainly helped by the fact that, again, when we expose to hydrogen atoms, we essentially see the same features. So on the basis of that, we assign these two electron polarons. Now, of course, we have to come to an assignment. What type of excitations do we see here? It's certainly not an excitation from the polaron ground state up in the conduction band. There we would expect energies which are much higher. The binding energy for a polaron below the band, upper band edge should be 300 milliV, if you ask Christina Di Valentin, which should show up later at this meeting, I believe. There are other papers in the literature where this energy actually is quite a bit higher. So we don't think this is a direct excitation. So actually, when we had these measurements, I came up with the idea that possibly we see excitations of electrons sitting in the polaron trap, like ground state, first excited state, second excited state. And so I conceived this picture. Works well on PowerPoint, but I'm afraid this cannot be correct. Actually, Georg Resse has allowed me to say if you do calculations, proper calculations for the perfect crystal, there's no way to find such excitations. So these features have certainly been seen by many groups, even for titania in contact with water. They are certainly relevant for chemistry occurring at these surfaces. I've said this point. Actually, I have a next slide coming to a paper by Peter Deak. But certainly, what we can already include at this point, that infrared, in particular infrared reflection absorption spectroscopy, is in principle able to see optical absorption from these polarons. So a short discussion of this paper by Peter Deak, which came out in 2015. So what he did is he looked at defects in titania, both oxygen vacancies and titanium interstitials. And what he finds, and so this is a quotation from his paper, that actually he doesn't spend too many details here, so exactly where this other polaron is localized, but he argues that in the case of these defects, and he says the titanium interstitials and the oxygen defects behave very similar, you may see such excitations which very well fit with the experiment. But it's really only this one sentence in the paper, and I feel one should work a little bit harder on that to find out what others and we have seen in these experiments. Okay, I will now move on using the same method to zinc oxide. So zinc oxide should be an interesting test for the system because, as you know, zinc oxide is a non-reducible oxide. And from theory, we already know that electron polarons are unstable in zinc oxide, and also small hole polarons should be unstable. This is work from Chris van der Walle, who is also in the audience and actually who helped me a few years ago a lot in understanding these systems. So let's look at the experiments. Again, as an experimentalist, you have to sometimes tell people in theory how difficult it is and what the advantage is to have this apparatus. Again, zinc oxide, if you look into transmission through bulk materials, this is what you see, again, in the regime of the optical phonons. You see a very strong absorption, and you have no chance in observing polaronic effects. So again, we do ERAS. So what you see here is data for a single crystal zinc oxide 1O minus 1O. Surface very well characterized with XPS, with low energy electron diffraction, and so on. And what we see again are strong features. Again, what you see here are different spectra before and after UV illumination. And you see that we get strong signals here, and that there is also a pronounced dependence on polarization. So the spectra recorded in S polarization, that would be the red one, are missing this sharp peak at 1288. But otherwise, we have very well defined sharp peaks introduced after UV elimination, which stay for quite some time. These data have been recorded at 120K. So now comes again the test, are these electron polarons or hole polarons? And again, we use the same recipe, we expose two hydrogen atoms. So this is a source, we operate in UHV. Basically, we have a hot filament and put hydrogen gas in the chamber, which is then dissociated at the filament. So we produce hydrogen atoms, which basically stick on everything. If you do this on zinc oxide, no effect. Unlike titania, exposure to hydrogen atoms does not show any effect. From that, we conclude that what we see in the infrared data is not electron polarons, but hole polarons in this case. Okay, so this would be the picture, how we see the system. And at this point, we felt we should team up with someone in theory to get a better understanding. And we teamed up with Patrick Rinke, and he did a rather careful analysis with DFT. Details are listed here. And so in reproducing earlier results, he found that there is no small electron or small hole polaron stable in zinc oxide. He found in the DFT calculations actually a large electron polaron and a large hole polaron, but their energy certainly did not fit. So this cannot explain our results. And then Patrick pointed out that actually there is a problem in DFT here, that in a straightforward way you can only handle small polarons and very large polarons using perturbation theory. But at this point, he started to speculate that there might be polarons with intermediate coupling strength. Okay, now I can refer to the talk we heard this morning about Fröhlich theory. I don't have to go into the details. So this is an approximation. And so Patrick decided to look at this formalism. And actually turns out that if you want to put in numbers here, you need information on the effective mass of the electrons. I don't have to repeat all these things again. I would like to remind you that this important parameter is this alpha. But in order to estimate alpha, you need the optical phonon frequency. This is easy. This is something you can look up. But you need then the effective mass. And so Patrick decided to pick this out of calculations. So you need curvature of the electronic bands. So this is what you see here. This is calculations he actually did earlier. And you see two bands of different curvature here. And then you can put this in a table here. And what you find is, again, this large electron polaron. Then we get a small hole polaron. We get a large hole polaron, which doesn't fit with the experiments. But then, interestingly, this other curvature with a larger effective mass gives you a hole polaron, which has a size of 15 angstroms. Again, to calculate this with DFT would require a very large unit cell, 3,000 atoms, so we stayed with this empirical theory. And so with a binding energy of 240 milliV. So now let's compare that with the experimental data. So first I have now to show you that we cannot only simply record data in what we call UV saturation. So we illuminate the sample and then measure the infrared spectra. Actually, our machine is powerful enough that we can also go into time resolution. Now, not femtoseconds or nanoseconds like people in these ultra-fast laser experiments do, but we can do like 10 milliseconds by using a technique which is called rapid scan in FTIR. And so this is how the data looks like. So we can illuminate the sample and then record spectra, and then at some point turn the light off and measure how fast the signal decays. So here in this case, at the temperature of 75K, takes about 25 seconds until the sample decays. And then we can do a rough analysis and actually find out that the activation energy for this decay amounts to about 245 milliV, which is in good agreement for a parameter alpha equal 3.1. Fröhlich parameter 3.1. Now we have to also see whether the absorption we see in the infrared is consistent with this value. And now again, just to remind you, the optical absorption of a polaron, we learned that this morning, starts where we have the optical phonons. For the Fröhlich parameter alpha equal 1, we would have absorption starting directly at the optical phonon frequency. But this value 3.1, which we determined from the binding energy, actually gives you a frequency of 2.5 times the optical frequency. And this gives you, actually gets you in rather good agreement with our experimental results. So our interpretation for the result for the zinc oxide would be that the feature we see at 1546 for both polarizations would be a bulk polaron, which can be described by Fröhlich theory with a parameter of alpha equals 3.1. And actually, Patrick then went into the analysis how a surface polaron should look like. And from his estimate, he would then argue that this sharp peak at 1290 is actually a surface hole polaron. And this would explain why we see this only in one polarization. Again, this is not an ab initio calculation, and I would be happy to receive comments from anyone on the validity of this approach, but I think this is a case where we certainly can use infrared spectroscopy to look at these excitations in a rather detailed way. I have a few minutes left, so I would like to go to another system. Again, I'm interested in photochemistry. So looking at these sodium tantalites is an appealing topic. They are among the most effective catalysts, photocatalysts with regard to water splitting. There has been a nice paper by Hiroshi Onishi a few years ago about strontium-doped photocatalysts, and so we got hold of some of these particles. So now these are not single crystals anymore. These are particles where we use, again, our apparatus, but not in reflection, but in transmission. They are thin enough, these particles are thin enough, so the optical phonons don't create a problem. Of course, I cannot tell you which of the surface does the effect. But anyway, let's look at it. So we looked at three different types of samples, undoped sodium tantalite, and then strontium-doped ones, and then ones where we have etched away the outer part of the surface. And interestingly, again, upon UV irradiation, we see again a clear feature in the infrared spectra, again at about 1020 wave numbers. This is consistent with previous work, but actually our cutoff frequency is a little bit lower. In the previous work, they used a calcium fluoride window or support to go through, and we are better off because we use calcium bromide, which has a lower cutoff frequency, so we can go to slightly lower frequency and resolve this peak better. So this is nice. Then we can go again and look at the time dependence. And in this case, interestingly, we see two different time constants, a fast time constant and a slower one. The decay is different for basically all the different frequencies. Here's a comparison of these different results. So this is the undoped material, and clearly doping it shifts this frequency, shifts this peak in this direction to larger wave numbers. And if we etch away the outer part, there's again a small shift. And now, of course, is again the question with the assignment, electron polarons, hole polarons. And so we did again the exposure to hydrogen. Of course, you can do that with the powders as well. And to be on the safe side, we did it immediately for hydrogen and deuterium to have a check. And you see again that we basically see the same feature. So in a straightforward way, we assign the sharp peaks seen in the infrared data to electron polarons, which sit in a shallow trap. We can then look again at the time dependence. So this is time-dependent data recorded at different temperatures. As I said before, there are two decay channels, and from the fast decay channel, we get an activation energy of 62 milliV. So this would be the conclusion on the tantalates. Again, we looked at this because it's such an effective photocatalyst, so we clearly can see something. The assignment, we have no support from theory here at this point. Only thing we can say, it must be electron polarons. We have determined a few numbers here. Right now, we are carrying out experiments on water splitting, and we can clearly relate the intensity of these bands with the water splitting occurring on the surface by directly monitoring the vibrational spectra from the adsorbed water molecules. And so we are right now trying to link this together. But let me repeat, we have no support from theory at this point here. So this already brings me to the summary. Again, our approach is to get information on polarons, but our goal is to do this for single crystals, and we have found this niche to look at the optical absorption of polarons using an infrared setup. We can look at ultraviolet-induced population of shallow traps, but also at hydrogen-induced traps, and by this distinguish between electron and hole polarons. I told you a little bit about the difference between powders and single crystals. Powders are nice to work with. For real applications later, like in photochemistry, they are the material to use. But of course, for theoretical analysis, they give you a lot of problems. And this is why we go for single crystals. Actually, during this meeting, there will be another talk, I believe, on carbon monoxide on the surface of titania interacting with polarons. There we also have some data acquired with this apparatus, but I will leave this to the other talk. I would also like to say that with this apparatus, so far we have been able to work with any dielectric we did put inside in reflection. So if anyone has a very exciting system where he has interesting theoretical predictions, we would be happy to look at it. This is a list of materials. We already looked at it. It's not quite complete. We also have calcite in it by now. So just let me know. And this is a list of my collaborators. And again, I would like to give credit to Patrick Rinke, who did the analysis for the zinc oxide system. With this, I would like to thank all of you for your attention. I'll be happy to take any questions you might have. Thank you.
Floor is open for questions or talk. It's very impressive to be able to do FTIR reflectance on dielectrics. I have a question, right? So, in the case of a zinc oxide, for example, I believe it's N-type.
Yeah.
So, which means you're only sensitive to hole polarons, not to electron polarons, because the space charge region would drive the electron to the bulk. Your sensitive region would be only the hole polaron. That's my first question.
Well, I mean, we can only work with the samples we have. You are certainly correct in stating that zinc oxide is normally N-doped. And this is the experiments we have. They fit with the theory in as far as there should be no electron polarons in zinc oxide, at least not small ones or medium-sized ones, yeah. If you give me a single crystal zinc oxide p-doped, I'll pay you a beer and I will immediately start with the measurements. So far, we have not been able to get hold of a real single crystal which is p-doped. Yeah.
So the second question is your assignment of the surface polaron in 1250-ish wave numbers, right? One way to check the surface polaron, is that it would be very sensitive to the dielectric environment. For example, if you have a layer of inert molecules of polar, that energy should shift.
This is an excellent suggestion, and I will put this on the list. I foresee that also as a result of this conference, we will have to do more experiments. We also want to check Peter Deak's statement that the features we see might be related to defects in the titania, and there is, of course, a straightforward way to check that. We can not completely get rid of them, but we can increase their number substantially by annealing, and then the absolute intensity of the features should rise. So, but I will put this on the list. You are fully right. Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, the samples we looked at were the best samples we could get, but we have recently done other experiments where we put electron acceptors on the surface, and we certainly know that our substrates are N-type. So any other material, if you give me the source, I will be happy to look at it, yeah. Sorry, I didn't fully understand.
So you're the world
quantitative. Yeah.
Am I correct in recalling that you saw a signal that you ascribed to bolons at 300 K?
Polarons.
Yeah, am I to
that? Yeah, polarons at 300 K, yeah. Yeah, I'm aware of that paper. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, John Henderson.
Yeah, yeah.
So if they cannot see a signal of bolon, you know, above a few tens of kelvins, so how can you see a signal of 300 kelvins?
Well, we had this discussion earlier this morning that we might have situations where we have bipolaron formation, which you don't see in EPR. So again, as I said when I started with my talk, this is the data we have. I don't claim we have a full understanding. We certainly don't, because this little model which I made with this shallow trap is certainly incorrect. So here's our data. We have done all the control experiments we did. I think we need to team up with colleagues in theory. we don't have a good, solid interpretation of these data point. Well, we would do the experiments which were just suggested. If there is such a situation, we would start to modify the surface by, for example, adsorbing molecules. For example, in the case of the tantalates, I didn't dwell on that. We can show that we can start to remove the polarons by putting water on it and then actually get dissociation. So we can do photochemistry. The other way would be to oxidize the surface or to put other types of dopants on the surface. So, and we could change the polarization. As I showed in the case of zinc oxide, we can change the polarization of the infrared light, which should also act differently depending on whether it's a surface feature or not. So we do have a few tricks we can play, not a unique knob where we can answer all questions. But we can work on that, yes. Yeah, no, this is the data I showed. We can look at the UV illumination. We can check how fast the signal raises. Of course, the signal, the UV light probably penetrates deeper in the bulk than our infrared sensitivity is. This is something I would have to think about. No immediate answer on that, sorry. It was the same, yeah. There was no difference. I mean, the shape was a little bit different. But otherwise, the situation... No, for the zinc oxide. I was on the wrong track. No, for the zinc oxide, we did not see any changes after hydrogen exposure. This is why I take this as a confirmation that we must have whole polarons in this case. I mean, what we have here is, as a basis of the collaboration with Patrick Ring, I think a rather satisfying explanation so far. So there could be additional feature, but our claim is that with this Fröhlich theory, using the effective masses determined from the calculation, we get what I would call a satisfying description until we have a possibility to do a full ab initio of these medium-sized polarons.
I mean, the binding energies are really huge for the polarons. I mean, this is usually, from my point of view, this is way off the Whereas, at the middle of the band gap, you have crossing from H plus to H
I mean, in our experiment, you see we start first with low exposures to hydrogen atoms and then increase the coverage. And we only saw the intensity of these features changing. So I think if we get to very high, I mean, we are working with bulk crystals. So we go through the surface in the bulk. So I don't think we get very high concentrations in the bulk. We know from other experiments that the hydrogen atoms happily diffuse inside the bulk. We have also measured other properties on the surface of the zinc oxide. So I think... The hydrogen is supposed to go inside and dissociate and give one electron in the conduction band. Yeah. Well, it is a little n-doped to start with, but...
No,